Indian girls, Indian girls, Indian girls, Indian girls. Oh, how I love those Indian girls.
These two full-length gowns are fine examples of Manitoulin Island fashion. On the left, a wine-colored evening dress, open on one shoulder and trimmed with fringe at the top. The skirt is slit at the side and trimmed with ribbon. On the right, a colorful open-neck dress that employs fringe in a very selective, tasteful manner. This dress is slit up both sides and gathered at the waist with a belt. Here we have two leather garments from the Manitoulin Islands. On the left, a pullover shirt decorated with beads and fringe. On the right, an attractive open front vest. Both of these designs are available from the Indian Trader, a Saskatoon-based company. This leather suit is being modeled by Darlene. Isn't that the greatest thing you've ever seen? That outfit is beautiful too. The top has fine navy blue beadwork that creates a striking contrast against the white border. The edge of the yoke is trimmed with fringe both front and back. The lower part of the sleeves are also complemented with just enough fringe to make a statement. On the left, a two-piece suit consisting of gaucho pants and matching top in deer hide. The two-tone effect is created by a reverse panel through the center of the outfit. This is further embellished with hand stitching of leather lace. The fringed suit on the right has a patterned top with slits at the sides. The red fringe trim across the bust and the bottom of the sleeves echoes the red of the pants. Native designs from across North America have inspired more than one Many Fingers creation. The adventurous geometrics we see here are from the Sioux. These rectangular panels on the shoulders show a diamond motif and are trimmed with ribbon. This variation we see the ribbon used again, this time on the edge of the yoke. These two matching suits of raw silk are both complemented with a silver belt. Every once in a while, we witness the return of a true classic. And speaking of classics, remember those great Western movies by Sergio Leone? Apparently, Colin does. For a classic design, what could be more appropriate than a classic material, always durable and attractive, the ever-popular denim, here trimmed with ribbon? Whether you're at home on the range or dressing to be seen in one of the world's fashion capitals, you won't be out of place in this versatile duster coat. Here's a contemporary women's version of the duster, also in denim trimmed with ribbon. This time, however, the Indian influence asserts itself to create a new dynamic effect. The departure from the traditional center back bend and substitution of long side slits enhances the garment's freedom of movement and restates a recurring theme in Indian fashion. This duster carries the variation a step further, with the elimination of the collar and widening and shortening the sleeves. Here, the diamond design seen earlier is repeated on the enlarged patch pockets and again across the semi-detached yoke. springtime suggests bright colors, and lavender is the color Bev is wearing. This suit consists of pants and a top with identical detail on the sides of the legs and sleeves. The open neck top is trimmed with ribbon across the bust and gathered at the waist with a tied sash. The duster is back again, this time in black denim. We see this one has the distinctive side vents Many Fingers uses on the women's version. The ribbon fringes are increased in length, and western conchos are also terrific details. Another western design not at all unfamiliar to cowboy costume is the riding chap theme. A loose-fitting midriff blouse in dark blue tops off these pants that borrow from the riding chap style. Incidentally, the cowboy version of this garment is very likely to have been derived from the full-length leather leggings worn by the Indians. Another great garment comes full circle. In fashion, a classic is a garment or accessory that never seems to go out of style. Like brogue shoes or denim Levi's, some may see regular wear throughout a lifetime. Here we'll see some very contemporary variations on one such classic, the blanket coat. This one Shirley is wearing is a Pendleton blanket coat entitled Northern Lights. The striking designs on these coats are Navajo inspired. Even to the casual observer, it is apparent that there are no side seams in some of these coats. It's this lack of side seams that gives each of these garments its distinctive shape and allows the design on the fabric to remain undisturbed. Rarely will you encounter such a harmonious unity of form, function, and design. The effect is absolutely stunning. These are actually artworks that you can wear. Any of the Pendleton blanket coats from the Many Fingers collection would be sure to turn heads in any major fashion market. If you leave, don't leave now. Please don't take my heart away. Promise me just one more night. Then we'll go our separate ways. When hours had time on our side. This jacket is a variation on the previous theme and includes a hood at the back. The wraparound effect is not as critical here because we can expect to see some construction detail on the sides of the garments coming up. The jacket on the left has deer antler buttons on the front and down the side. On the right, a similar design uses designer buttons. Both jackets have a large hood and curving hemline, which is longer in the back. The classic blanket coat continues to assert its well-deserved longevity, this time in a variation on the famous Hudson's Bay blanket coat. On the left, Violet is wearing a loose-fitting Hudson's Bay blanket coat fastened with deer horn buttons and trimmed with wool. The leggings are also a matching Hudson's Bay pattern of red, yellow, green, and blue. Lori on the right displays a similar loose-fitting jacket with matching leggings. In this case, the decorative details are provided by caribou tufting on the leggings and sides of the jacket. In the last 15 years, caribou and moose hair tufting has become a marketable and even profitable craft for Indians. In this white two-piece outfit, the blouse can be loosened or tightened by adjusting a small buckle on the strap fasteners at the sides. Notice the arrowhead designs on the collar, bustline, and lower front of the skirt vents. This is another Indian design motif that has become popular in modern Western wear. from Morasty Fashions, a bright red, full-length gown with side slits. The bottom is edged in white, which partially frames the lively design down the front. The unadorned, collarless neck and short sleeves give this garment a relaxed, comfortable appearance. Lori is wearing a loose, free-fitting blue-black satin gown, also from Morasty Fashions. The neck is collarless, and as on the previous gown, creates a very comfortable look. A jewel is set into the eye of the great eagle design on the front. The sweaters we'll be seeing from Peru are pure alpaca. The animal is a cousin to the llama, but with softer fur. The peasant women of Peru spin the alpaca into skeins. Some of these sweaters are hand-knit, while others are made on a machine. The subtle shades are obtained with the use of natural dyes. These sweaters are traditional designs of the Peruvian Indians who are descendants of the Incas. The sweater Ron is wearing has a V-neck, while Clarence proudly displays the crew-neck version. For a night out on the town, here's a two-piece silk suit that wouldn't be at all out of place in a fashionable discotheque. The knee-length black skirt is topped with a bright crimson boat-neck blouse that's edged with a repeating triangle design. The top is gathered at the waist with a wide black belt that completes the look. On this blue satin evening dress, the designer buttons along the border, the belt, as well as the bow around Shirley's neck are all black for a subtle contrast. The uneven hemline creates an elfin effect. Here, Lori displays a variation on the same outfit in a blue-black. This time, the contrast is increased by the selection of magenta as the color for the buttons and accessories. They say the nicest things come in small packages. Here's a neat little package from Morasty Fashions of Meadow Lake. A matching skirt and blouse with contrasting fringe. Most often the hemline is where a fringe will hang loose. On this skirt, the fringe starts above and ends at the hemline. The detail here is in shiny silver, which is repeated in the accessories with silver earrings, bracelet, and belt. Ron sure looks good in this cozy crewneck sweater from Peru. The design of this sweater has been kept simple with no extra adornment. As we can see, there's no need to embellish a good design. Arlene is wearing a two-piece ballroom ensemble in brown satin. The skirt is laced up the side, as is the sleeveless top. Both the skirt and top are very liberated in the use of silver stars and conchos. The design on the front of the top echoes the shape of the diagonal hemline. Also in brown satin is this one-piece knee-length dress Shaunine is wearing. Like the previous outfit, this one is also collarless, but this time we see short sleeves. Gold-colored metallic arrow designs decorate the neck, front, and hemline. Here's one of the best ways to keep warm while looking good. Even the color of this dressy alpaca sweater is a warm tan. Cable stitching provides a decorative touch along the sleeves and either side of the front. A good Shirley's light blue one-piece dress from Morasti Fashions is trimmed with fringe at the neck, shoulders, and hemline. A matching cloth sash which gathers the waist is also fringed. The dramatic addition of colorful beads on the fringe is the only other form of decoration on this outfit. Darlene sure looks pleased with this elegant sleeveless one-piece dress. That red belt makes the white satin look even whiter. This dress also has fringe at the neck, shoulders, and hem. The curve of the hemline echoes that of the neckline. Once again, two Peruvian sweaters, this time with convenient zipper fronts. The sweater on the right is very comfortable looking in warm gray. On the left, a two-tone design in blue with a darker blue yoke across the front and upper sleeves. From Morasti Fashions, a three-quarter length, one-piece lavender dress, very suitable for evening wear. The ribbon detail over the center vent in the back is very similar to the bow at the neck. This beautiful alpaca sweater from Peru is in the classic pullover style. Its versatile burgundy color and V-neck make this a garment that would complement almost any combination in your wardrobe. The three-quarter length dress makes another appearance. Here is a very stylish belted one-piece. The slits at the hemline, neck, and sleeve openings are all accented by a two-tone ribbon trim in red and white. The colored ribbon against the delicately patterned gray background gives this dress a decidedly feminine quality. A single side slit is all that's required to create the desired effect on this full-length one-piece dress. The slit neck opening and hemline are trimmed with lavender ribbon. At the bust, the ribbon is allowed to hang free, almost to the knee. The sleeves are also trimmed with ribbon, which gathers the sleeve back at the wrist. These two attractive sweaters with boat neck tops are another example of the fine craftsmanship in the garments from Peru. The sweater on our left, in light gray, uses a cable stitch design, while the one on the right has a subtle geometric pattern incorporated into the knit. Here's two more garments from Peru. This time it's ponchos. Both are woven of alpaca, and both designs, although simple, are very effective. The poncho Ron is wearing is red with a red-white striped border. Colin is wearing a poncho of a blue-green color with a gray band along each side and through the center. The hat Colin is wearing is also alpaca with the designs woven right in. Something particularly pleasing about the look of black on white, as we see in this one-piece black belted dress in white satin. Black lace encircles the garment just above the knee and around the top. The asymmetrical off-the-shoulder look is further complemented by the curved and pleated hemline. These elegant outfits are from Aikido's Fashions in British Columbia. Shawneen is wearing an ensemble in dark brown that includes a poncho with two-color ribbon trim, a theme that's repeated on the skirt. On our right, Bev displays a two-tone skirt and vest ensemble in rust and tan. The top features fringe at the neckline and yoke, deer horn buttons, laced stitching, and a scalloped edge. You can't beat black leather for simple elegance, and elegant is how you'd have to describe this sleek two-piece pantsuit. The short collarless jacket is decorated with conchos, which also appear above the slits at the side of the pant legs. Dancing on the ballroom floor is where you'll want to be in a graceful blue evening gown like this. The side slit in the skirt is a theme that is also stated in the upper sleeves, which are very large and loose. The upper edges are all trimmed with a glittery silver border. A matching blue sash gathers the waist. The most striking feature about this tan two-piece suit is the belted poncho top. The diamond-shaped top is open-collared, and the concho belt gathers the front part of the garment, leaving the back undisturbed. On our left, a white two-piece suit consisting of a knee-length skirt and pullover top again displays some of the many variations of the side or back slit. These also appear at the shoulder. Shiny rays of light descending from the neckline create a decorative element. On our right, a three-quarter length dress in turquoise blue. The lower part of the skirt is accented with contrasting ribbon and is gathered for a ruffled effect. The silver bracelet and concho belt are excellent choices for accessories. These two designs are both made of suede. In this outfit, we see a pullover top with short fringed sleeves which are laced up the sides. The knee-length skirt is unusual. The appearance of the slit at the front instead of the rear defies predictability. The outfit on the left is decorated with shells at the bottom of the sleeves and above the fringe along the diagonal hemline. An excellent example of attention to fine detail. Here's another elegant outfit in that classic material, black leather. The top is low at the neck, decorated with flowers, fringe, and a white border at the neck and sleeves. The skirt is also edged with fringe, and a silver Indian-style belt adds another touch of contrast. From Aikido's Fashions, a very simple but striking knee-length blue dress with an unusual scalloped hemline. A low neckline and slit sleeves again displays the charming decorative border. Wearing a two-piece white leather ensemble that consists of a mid-calf length slit skirt and short-sleeve pullover top. All the decoration on this outfit is on the top, which is gathered with a concho belt. Long fringes hang from the diamond-shaped hemline, while a collarless neckline is bordered with feather designs from arrow shafts. This two-piece evening outfit is made of reversed leather. The short-sleeved top is stitched with leather lace and decorated with flower designs on the front. The one-piece, three-quarter-length dress has very narrow shoulder straps, side slits at the hemline, and laces up the center back. The only feature on the dress that is exclusively decorative are the three beaded feather tufts across the bust. Both of these two-piece skirt suits uses a beaded arrow feather motif as decoration. On our left, the yoke skirt is slit in the back. The vest has a matching yoke and long fringe with beads at the top. The entire white leather outfit is stitched with leather lace. On our right, the skirt of this cream-colored leather suit is left plain. The main design features adorn the belted pullover top. The hemline is scalloped in a zigzag pattern which is repeated and decorated with beadwork below the neck. The top of this outfit is a very simple fringed pullover gathered at the waist with a belt. The sleeves are elbow length and continue the line suggested by the diamond-shaped hemline. The skirt, which is stitched with leather lace, has a single side slit. This one-piece V-neck pullover dress from Aikido's Fashions displays a unique feature. The slits at the hemline are rounded at the corner. The beaded belt matches the beadwork on the neckline and on the short fringed sleeves. Turquoise is a popular material with the Navajo. Here we have a full-length wide-skirted hostess dress in turquoise blue. The waist is gathered with a very striking belt that further suggests the Navajo influence. Buckskin can be used to create almost any desired effect, from utilitarian and rustic to sophisticated and chic. In this two-piece buckskin outfit, we see how the rustic look can complement a very sophisticated design. The skirt is stitched with leather lace and the zigzag hemline is slightly fringed. The small top is also stitched with lace and fringed at the waist and bust. Two thin shoulder straps support the top and complement the design. Shirley is wearing a belted red satin top that is decorated with a two-color diagonal line across the bust. The dropped shoulders give this sleeveless tunic the illusion of very short, wide sleeves. The side slashes on the top are repeated in the sides of the contrasting white pants. A tied Ojibwe belt is used to gather the waist of this traditional Indian-style pullover tunic. The curve of the collarless neckline is repeated in the fringed yoke and hemline. The shoulders are low with the yoke fringes covering the upper part of the arm. The matching white skirt has a decorative border above the hemline. Left, a one-piece reverse leather dress with fringed yoke and hemline uses a diamond shape for the neckline and yoke. The side slits of the skirt have the unique rounded corners seen earlier. On the right, a two-piece skirt suit uses both the grain and flesh sides of the leather to create contrast in color and texture. The sleeveless top has a low collar that matches the contrasting skirt. The decorative zigzag border above the hemline of the skirt is achieved with a row of stitching and leather lace, a feature used liberally on both outfits. The button front of this sleeveless white chamois top has a unique feature. It fastens down one side. The belted waist, fringed hemline, and extended shoulders are a variation on themes we've seen previously. However, the collarless square neckline adds a new element to the many possible combinations. Here again, we see the unusual rounded corners on the side slits of the matching skirt. This distinguished-looking ensemble has a knee-length skirt with a center back vent and a matching collarless tunic top. A shiny metallic border decorates the hemline on the back of the tunic, and a row of similar metallic arrowheads fastens the front at an attractive angle. Here's a sleek-looking, shiny outfit in a bronze color. The tapered pants are topped off with a variation of the three-piece suit vest, here laced up and tied at the front. We've been looking at a lot of fantastic designs that show imaginative use of ribbon, but here is the design that most deserves to be called the ribbon dress. This full-length belted evening gown in light turquoise is slit up one side to just above the knee. The neckline, high in front and open in the back, is trimmed with pale blue ribbon, which ends in a dramatic waterfall-like cascade of ribbon that reaches toward the floor. fringed and beaded capuchin-style shawl tops off this striking two-piece outfit of reversed leather. The three-quarter length dress is supported by thin shoulder straps that end at a border of short fringe across the bust. The long fringe on the bottom is cut increasingly higher toward one side, creating an asymmetrical variation on the diamond theme. How could such a magnificent collection of garments be complete without an appearance by that perennial classic, the wraparound skirt? Here's an exquisitely detailed example of a one-piece belted dress with an attached wraparound skirt. The front and hemline are finished in white leather edge lacing, as are the short sleeves and diamond-shaped neck. A row of fringe around the back, shoulders, and bust is carefully beaded with small shells. This white leather one-piece dress employs a simple geometric design that becomes even more effective through its use again around the edge of an unusual shaped Western-style yoke. Here again we see the knee-length hemline is slit up one side. Shirley Morasty is wearing a two-piece leather outfit with a skirt that ends just below the knee. The reversed leather top has a cardigan-style button front and is gathered at the waist by a braided leather belt. The short sleeves and gracefully curving hemline both end in a generous border of fringe. And while we have the inclination, we'll conclude with another generous display of fringe on this dazzling two-piece skirt suit in sea green. The fringed hemlines of both the skirt and belted tunic are diamond-shaped, suggesting the movement of rolling waves. This theme continues with a long spray of white fringe just below the V-shaped neckline. These details collaborate with the white back panel of the tunic to create the impression of tidal rhythms in this spectacular design.
Ladies, can you make your way in a line right along the front of the stage? That's it. Right up the center of the stage. And Paul from Peru, would you come up, please? And Isaac Beaulieu, your glasses are steaming. Ladies and gentlemen, the models that you've seen here this afternoon at the 7th Annual Native American Languages Issues Institute, would you please give them a warm round of applause for the super wonderful job they've done keeping themselves in shape and presenting these clothing in such an admirable, admirable, and wonderful way. Now, I would like... Oh, well, I better not rush them. I would now like to introduce the fashion designers. Ladies, would you please step out on the platform? I know usually you're behind the scene. And Shirley, would you go out there too, please? And Paul. Paul. Okay, we have then the Ictus Fashions from British Columbia. We have Millie Godfredson, a lady who won the 1964 Mother of the Year Award, 1978 Canada Medal. And now she's made her dream come true by being a fashion designer. And Millie, I don't know if you realize it, but by looking at your beautiful fashions, I never even knew I had that dream to be an MC at a fashion show, but now I know it must have been a dream because, gosh, it sure was nice. Thank you, Millie. And then we have Jerry. No, just stay there, Millie. And then we have Jerry Manyfingers from Cardston, Alberta. I don't know where, Jerry, you got all these wonderful ideas for your fashions, But keep it up because it sure looks nice. I guess fashion designing is something like writing a song. When you write a song, you're always looking around at different people and see what's happening. If it's anything like that, well, by gosh, I guess I'm just going to have to stay in the fashion designing business here as an MC. Sure is nice. I'll never bring my wife. And then Shirley Morasty from Waterhen Lake, Saskatchewan. I know that the boys from Waterhen Lake, they make some of the best log cabins in northern Saskatchewan and Alberta in the construction business. And Shirley, it looks like you've been doing some really good construction work too with these fantastic designs that you've been making. So please keep up the good work. I hope to see some of your work, all of you, in some of our fashion magazine, World Fashion Magazines. There is nobody that has designs like the Indian people. Remember, at the end of this, there'll be no sales made right here on the floor. You'll have to go up to their rooms, lucky guys. And Paul? What? From Peru, Peru, introducing the only pale face on our show this afternoon. Paul Dick, but yeah. Paul,
Indian girls. Hey, thank you.